We've spoken many times in the past about the Reinhard Galen spy outfit, Martin, something which was to a certain extent an outgrowth of the Galen Western Military and Intelligence Alliance, something that we have not spoken about in some of our past discussions except in passing, and that is some of the many manifestations of Operation Stay Behind. Could you tell us a little about that?
That's actually a very, very interesting subject that one can spend a long time talking about. I actually had written quite a bit about that, but because of editing considerations, I had to keep some of it out of the book. Operation Stay Behind, or what we know about as the Stay Behind operation, was first exposed in Italy. See, what it was really was an operation put in motion by the CIA during the Cold War, relatively early speaking now, 49, 50, 51 is when it first starts. And the CIA had this idea that it was important to have ready and waiting in different countries in Western Europe a group of people who were trained in paramilitary exercises and techniques who would be willing, if in the event of a Soviet invasion, to surface after the invasion. They would, quote-unquote, stay behind the enemy lines in the areas now occupied by the Soviet Union. This is, of course, all theoretical. And then they would be activated. These stay-behind units would be brought alive to engage in sabotage and in operations against the Soviet occupation forces.
Well, this would also apply in the event of a democratic takeover of a Western European country.
Well, this is, of course, the ostensible purpose that I just described. This was the official purpose. But in many different countries, what we find is that the stay-behind forces that were trained and set up by the CIA in conjunction with the police and secret services and military of the specific countries like Italy and Germany and West Germany and elsewhere, that these units ended up actually having another purpose, which they pursued, and that was to intervene in the event of a domestic disturbances. If things went awry as far as the U.S. was concerned, if it looked like leftists would come to power in Italy, for example, where there was a strong communist party, in order to prevent that from happening, it seems that these stay-behind units were used to intervene in these countries. And there are several examples, both of in Turkey and Italy, most notably, where certain personnel associated with these stay-behind units do seem to figure in acts of terrorism and acts of political intervention that had nothing whatsoever to do with stopping or thwarting a Soviet occupation or invasion, but everything to do with manipulating the domestic political situation so that the United States could achieve a covert political objective that it sought.
You write of the strategy of tension in Italy and also of some of the Grey Wolf-connected activities in Turkey.
Well, the Grey Wolves in Turkey is quite interesting because the Grey Wolves, which is a Turkish neo-Nazi group whose most famous member, Mehmet Ali Agca, shot Pope John Paul II in May of 1981. That's how a lot of people first heard about the Grey Wolves. But the Grey Wolves were linked to a unit within the Turkish military called the Contra Guerrilla Unit, which was sort of spun out of a Turkish military effort that was guided and directed by the United States. So bureaucratically, actually the same building that housed the Special Forces Unit of the Turkish military that gave birth to these counter-guerrilla soldiers that were actually fighting Kurdish separatists and Turkish leftists and being used as an instrument of repression in Germany. You can actually sort of trace this group back to the CIA through its involvement with this particular unit of the Turkish military that was setting these things up. And it's an example, again, how a unit ostensibly set up in case of a Soviet invasion was actually used to intervene politically in Turkey. I mean, Italy also, there's some very tantalizing evidence, some hard and well-established links between stay-behind personnel in Italy, and that and the stay-behind operation was actually called Gladio. I'm sure you've talked about it on your program before. But there are a few instances in which people directly linked to Gladio are involved in acts of terrorism in Italy. There's really two or three hard and fast documented examples of that. Some people suggest that it was actually much more extensive and that much of the terrorism that scarred Italy in the beginning in the late 60s through the 70s into the early 80s was all part of a strategy of attention, that was sort of orchestrated by Italian secret services and probably American secret services as well. That might be stretching it a bit based on the evidence that's actually known and established, but certainly certain acts involving the Gladio personnel are linked to terrorism.
You also write of the Greek stay-behind contingent and some of their activities.
Yes, the Greek stay-behind personnel were involved in the 1967 military coup that brought a repressive right-wing, some would say pro-fascist, junta to power in Greece, which stayed in power for several years, and stay-behind personnel, again, that was supposed to be trained to thwart a Soviet invasion of Greece, if such a thing is even imaginable, in fact were utilized to intervene in Greek politics and basically smash the democratic structures of the cradle of democracy. That's what happened. And Greece is still suffering as a result of what happened there, even though now it's the Greek military junta has not been in power for several years, but still the country has never quite recovered.
And you mentioned that some of those stay-behind people in Greece had also been active collaborators with the Nazi occupation.
Well, what happened there again is that this process whereby it came down to a choice. The British were particularly active in Greece during this period. When World War II was drawing to a close, there was a civil war that erupted in Greece between communists and right-wing reactionaries and fascists.
Mm-hmm.
And rather than support the resistance to Hitler, which was led by the communists, the British and ultimately the Americans sought to throw their weight behind the ultra-right-wing forces. Hence, many collaborators of Hitler benefited and were in Greece, were able to seize power, and the left was sort of kept on the ropes there for a long time.
There's a good book by Dominique Yudish called The Kapitanios, talking about the Greek resistance in World War II and what it led to in the immediate aftermath of the Second World War. Martin, this is probably a very good place to terminate this half of the interview and turn over our tape.
Okay.
We've been speaking with Martin A. Lee, the author of The Beast Reawakens, published in hardcover by Little Brown, a vitally important recent book talking about the reemergence of fascism. For Martin Lee, this is Dave Emery saying thanks for listening.